Yes. So, good evening, everyone, and thank you very much for joining in another round of our masterclass. This is our 12th masterclass. We have been doing it pre-pandemic. We started this masterclass initiative, and I'm happy to share that we are completing our 12th masterclass today. So, this topic for this masterclass is a very interesting one, and I had a very detailed conversation before coming up with this topic with Manish, and we generally have 2-3 approaches of investing. One is a top-down approach, another is a bottoms-up approach, right? The bottoms-up approach is all about identifying the right stocks, checking the earning potential of that stock, growth of that stock. If the management doesn't deliver, exit that stock. That is the basic tenet of bottoms-up investing. Whereas a macro-based investing is all about economy, right? The market works on cycle. So that school of thought, there are less people who have been following that. And I've been fortunate enough to have in touch with Manish on that part, on macro-based investing. So today we have Mr. Manish Dangi, founder of MDIS Capital. And he's ex-co-CIO and head of fixed income at Birla Sun Life Asset Management, where he used to manage almost 1.5 lakh assets. And he has been managing, working with a team of many fund managers and analysts. So Manish is known for his macro-based investing approach in equities based on various market cycles and economic cycles. So last year, again, that's an interesting one. Manish made a strong call in 2020 to buy into mid and small cap stocks when globally we were at the peak of the corona crisis. The confidence then in the market was low, demand was affected, and inflation was also affected. Now times have changed and market sentiments are high, economies are reviving, and earning growth seems to be coming back. But equally opposing forces which are in play are the supply side constraint, oil prices touching high every day, inflation inducing faster tapering, expectation from central banks over. So considering all these economic challenges, we are reaching out to Manish for his view. So in this reverse situation, Manish has asked high-risk investors to be cautious and prudent as the macroeconomic indicators point towards potential volatility in the coming months. So what are these macro indicators? How long does he foresee volatility? And is India inching towards the end of the bull run? Some of these questions may be running through our mind. And so let's begin today's conversation and understand Manish's perspective on the equity markets ahead from a macroeconomic standpoint. So we are excited for Manish to enlighten us on the macroeconomic template, which has delivered handsomely for him for over decades and also helped him avoid major drawdowns throughout his illustrious career. So before we begin, a few pointers for our attendees. This will be a very free-flowing session, and we expect that as the session progresses, post your questions in the comment column, and we will try best to address them. We will have some polls also running here, so we would request everyone's participation in those polls. So before I start, I want to run a small poll, which will really help Manish also to set the background of this conversation. So I have just launched one poll. My request to everyone, if they can take this poll. Thank you. Not many have taken that poll. My request is, can you please take this poll? So there are, I think we are getting some answers. Yes. Manish bhai, you can see the poll, right? I think you are on mute.
I can't see,
Oh, you
but
can't. One second, I'll just end the poll. That time we can see that.
Okay.
So I'll just read out. My first question was, so based on your current view on the equity markets and economy, which cycle do you presently think we are in? Early cycle, mid cycle, or late stage cycle? I can see 50% feel it's a mid cycle, 21% feel it's an early cycle, and 29% feel it's a late stage cycle. Second question is, based on your understanding of today's session, what would be your view? What would be your view to be overweight on? And 73% are large cap equities and index fund overweight, 27% small and mid cap equities, and 7% is debt. And on the scale of file, I think that's not a question, correct question. So I think this is where we wanted to start. Thank you very much. Yes. So
to start?
Yeah, over to you, Manish bhai. Yes.
Yeah. Thanks, Arun. And I think you sort of set up the context pretty right. And also the questions were relevant. You know, I think the house also is already of the view that we are in a mid-cycle, which sort of I agree with a tinge of at least some believing that it's late stage and some believing that it's early cycle. So my arguments would be that it's not at all early cycle, and I'll try and convince people that it's not early cycle. But it you know, I have to set a context of what I think as early cycle, maybe just in a while. I think, you know, again, maybe your advice, plus, you know, of course, people's choices with respect to large cap equities and index fund is the right way to go. I sort of agree with people here. So in a sense, in a sense that I'm actually going to talk to an audience who primarily agree with me in any case. But nonetheless, let's move forward, you know. So let me first sort of set the context of what a macro investing is, Hannah, and which is and how is it in contrast to bottom up investing? Okay, there are various ways to access markets. Bottom up investing primarily is about identifying good businesses and managements and actually backing them with your capital. Whereas the macro investing is all about buying risky assets in a macro which is suitable for risk assets, and we'll try and define what's suitable for risk assets. But so macro is less bothered about, you know, an independent individual businesses of sorts, and more bothered about the policy setup and the big picture macro of an economy that, you know, businesses are
Manish
operating.
Manish bhai, my request is, there are many investors who may be very happy to have a Hinglish also. So you can be free enough to talk the way you want. Huh?
Yes, absolutely. No, I'll sort of keep switching. I am sitting in Rajasthan. I usually speak to everyone here in Hindi. And so I need to change the tempo. So I'll get there. So basically, badi baat ye hai ki, what I'm going to discuss with all of you is ki macro investing ek approach hai investing ka jo bottom up investing se contrast mein hai. It is different. So kya differences hain? So main bata raha tha ki jo macro investing ka approach hai wo is pe depend karta hai ki kis tarah se policy cycles evolve ho rahe hain. यानी कि आरबीआई और गवर्नमेंट किस तरह से इंक्रीमेंटली उनके जो एक्शंस हैं वो ग्रोथ ओरिएंटेड है या इन्फ्लेशन ओरिएंटेड है. यानी कि ग्रोथ ओरिएंटेड जो एक्शंस होंगे उसके अंदर वो ज्यादा खर्चा करेंगे. जब ग्रोथ ओरिएंटेड एक्शंस होंगे तो रियल रेट्स नीचे रखेंगे. और जो कोई सारी पॉलिसी माइक्रो पॉलिसीज भी जो अनाउंस करेंगे वो जैसे कि टैक्स कट करेंगे, तो ये सब चीजें जो है वो रिफ्लेशनरी मूव्स होते हैं. उसकी वजह से स्पेशली जो क्राइसिस होता है उसके बाद जब इकोनॉमीज उससे रिकवर कर रही होती है और बहुत गवर्नमेंट आरबीआई और जो दूसरी पॉलिसी मेकर्स हैं, इफ दे इंट्रोड्यूस रिफ्लेशन इन द इकोनॉमी इन अ सेंस कि दे इंड्यूस मोर ग्रोथ इन द इकोनॉमी, उससे क्या होता है कि सारी फर्म्स का जो कलेक्टिव प्रॉफिट पूल है वो बढ़ता है ना, और जनरली जो रिस्क एपेटाइट है भी इन्वेस्टर का वो भी बढ़ता है. तो इस तरह से मैक्रो इन्वेस्टिंग जो है वो ब्रॉडर, एज यू सेड ना तरुण, दैट यू नो इट्स एक्चुअली मोर अबाउट बिग पिक्चर, इट्स मोर अबाउट ऑल द कंपनीज टुगेदर. इंस्टेड द बॉटम अप इन्वेस्टिंग इज अबाउट अ पर्टिकुलर बिजनेस, है ना, एक यूनिक बिजनेस. आप अगर टेक्सटाइल का बिजनेस चला रहे हो, सीमेंट बिजनेस चला रहे हो, तो वो सीमेंट का बिजनेस कैसा है, मैनेजमेंट कैसा है, कहाँ प्लांट डाला है, लाइमस्टोन की एक्सेस है या नहीं है, ओवरऑल का ऑपरेटिंग कॉस्ट कम है या ज्यादा है, इन सब के बेसिस पे एक आप जो एवरेज बॉटम अप इन्वेस्टर होता है, जो फंड मैनेजर टिपिकली इंडिया में है, या फिर जो सारे जो फैन क्लब्स हैं हमारे, यू नो, सारे बड़े इन्वेस्टर्स का, वो उसी तरह के लोग हैं जो जो बिजनेसेस को समझते हैं, मैनेजमेंट्स को समझते हैं, और उन बिजनेसेस को बैक करते हैं जो 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 उनके हिसाब से बेहतर मैनेज करते हैं अपनी कैपिटल को, और आरओईज और ग्रोथ दोनों इम्प्रूव्ड रिलेटिव टू अदर कंपनीज, यू नो, दे डिलीवर. सो दैट इज द बॉटम अप इन्वेस्टिंग. मैक्रो इन्वेस्टिंग जैसे मैंने बताया कि वो पॉलिसी आउटलुक क्या है, डेट डेमोग्राफिक्स और का कैसे उस देश के अंदर इवोल्यूशन हो रहा है, तो वो मैक्रो इन्वेस्टिंग का जो बंदा है वो इन सब चीजों पे जो बिग पिक्चर मैक्रो को देख करके रिस्क एपेटाइट को मेजर करता है अपनी. तो देखो, है ना, दो बड़ी बातें हैं. एक तो है कि बॉटम अप इन्वेस्टिंग का प्राइमरली जो इन्वेस्टिंग होता है वो एब्सोल्यूट होता है, इन अ सेंस कि जैसे मुझे मुझे रिलायंस इंडस्ट्रीज अच्छा लगता है ना, क्योंकि मेरे हिसाब से वो ठीक से बिजनेस करते हैं, वो ऑपरेटिंग एफिशिएंसीज है उनका, वो सही एरियाज के अंदर बिजनेस में कैपिटल डाल रहे हैं, तो इसलिए मैं रिलायंस इंडस्ट्रीज खरीदता हूँ. मैं रिलायंस की जियो को खरीदना चाहता हूँ, उसका वजह है क्योंकि मेरे हिसाब से वो शायद भारतीय से बेहतर कैपिटल एलोकेट कर रहे हैं, राइट टेक्नोलॉजी में है, एंड सो एंड सो फोर्थ, है ना. तो माइक्रो इन्वेस्टिंग जो होता है वो रिलायंस इंडस्ट्रीज के पूल को वनस्पत भारती के मेजर करेगा और उस हिसाब से रिलायंस को इंडस्ट्री को वैल्यू करता है. जनरली जब तक बिजनेस और मैनेजमेंट से रिलेटेड जो बैड न्यूज डज नॉट स्टार्ट पोरिंग इन, पीपल आर जनरली, बॉटम अप इन्वेस्टर्स आर जनरली सॉर्ट ऑफ अ लॉन्ग ओनली इन्वेस्टर. मैक्रो का क्या होता है कि आप ना रिलायंस इंडस्ट्री कैसा कर रहा है उसमें बहुत बड़ा रेलेवेंस नहीं है. बेसिकली रेलेवेंस ये है कि जो सारी फर्म्स हैं, जैसे इंडिया के अंदर रेलेवेंट फर्म्स हैं, जैसे 500 फर्म्स हैं, उनका कलेक्टिवली वो लोग कैसा कर रहे हैं. तो क्या होता है कि सरप्राइजिंगली अगर आप ठीक से रिसर्च करेंगे तो आपको लगेगा कि अरे यार, इन सारी 500 फर्म का जो कलेक्टिव प्रॉफिट है वो इंडिविजुअल फर्म क्या कर रही है उससे बहुत फर्क नहीं पड़ता है, जो इंडिविजुअल मैनेजमेंट क्या कर रहा है उससे बहुत फर्क नहीं पड़ता है. फर्क इससे पड़ता है कि आपकी ओवरऑल पॉलिसी आर्किटेक्चर कैसा है और किस आपका इकोनॉमी में जो कंज्यूमर है, बैंकिंग सिस्टम वो कैसे बिहेव कर रहा है, और आपकी पॉपुलेशन एज किस पेस पे हो रही है, या रिलेटिवली एज हो रही है या रिलेटिवली यंगर हो रही है. तो इन सब की वजह से एक मैक्रो सेटअप बनता है जिसमें आप ये डिसाइड कर सकते हैं कि आप इक्विटी में रहेंगे, बॉन्ड में रहेंगे, डॉलर में रहेंगे, या इंडियन करेंसी में रहेंगे, क्रेडिट में रहेंगे, या ट्रिपल ए में रहेंगे. तो ये जो सारे क्वेश्चन एक इंडेक्स लेवल पे बनते हैं कि इक्विटी वर्सेस बॉन्ड, या डॉलर वर्सेस करेंसी, या फिर एज आई सेड क्रेडिट वर्सेस नॉन क्रेडिट, ये सारे डिसीजन जो है वो मैक्रो के सेटअप के हिसाब से वन डिसाइड्स एक्चुअली. सो इन ए सेंस आई ट्राई टू पैरामीटराइज दैट किस तरह से इन्वेस्टिंग फ्रेमवर्क इन दोनों चीजों का अलग होता है. हालांकि इवेंचुअली बॉटम अप इन्वेस्टिंग को भी मे बी सिर्फ बाय ओनली नहीं होता है, यू नो, यू एक्चुअली बाय असेट्स एंड यू ऑल्सो हैव टू सेल असेट्स, इन अ सेंस दैट कई लोगों को ये बिकॉज यू नो लॉट ऑफ फंड मैनेजर्स एंड लॉट ऑफ पीपल एक्चुअली टॉक अबाउट बाय एंड होल्ड स्ट्रेटजी. बाय एंड होल्ड स्ट्रेटजी इज नॉट बॉटम अप इन्वेस्टिंग, बिकॉज बाय एंड होल्ड स्ट्रेटजी सरप्राइजिंगली एक्चुअली इज वन ऑफ द वर्स्ट परफॉर्मिंग असेट क्लास स्टाइल. बिकॉज टिपिकली क्या होता है कि हर कुछ सालों में, 20-25 सालों में एवरेज फर्म जो है वो डाइज एक्चुअली. सो इसलिए आपके लिए इम्पोर्टेंट है कि आप उन्हीं फर्म्स को बैक करो जो ग्रोथ ओरिएंटेड है और वेल कैप अपनी कैपिटल को ठीक से एलोकेट कर रही है. तो बॉटम अप स्ट्रेटजी में भी एग्जिट उतना ही इंपॉर्टेंट है जितना मैक्रो में. लेकिन बॉटम अप स्ट्रेटजी का एग्जिट स्ट्रेटजी जो है वो बिजनेस ओरिएंटेड होता है, और वो एक बिजनेस से दूसरे बिजनेस में मूवमेंट इज हाउ यू नो बॉटम अप एक्चुअली कैलिब्रेट्स इज सॉर्ट ऑफ पोर्टफोलियो एलोकेशन. मैक्रो स्ट्रेटेजी में दो बिजनेस का कंपैरिजन नहीं है. मैक्रो स्ट्रेटेजी में आपका कंपैरिजन असेट्स लेवल पे होता है. यू नो व्हाट आई मीन बाय दैट इज दैट यू नो हाउ इक्विटी इन एज एन इंडेक्स ओके द टॉप 500 टॉप 2000 फर्म हाउ देयर वैल्यूएशन एंड इक्विटी रिस्क प्रीमियम और जो उसमें ग्रोथ आपको मिलेगी हाउ इज दैट प्लेस्ड वर्सेस बॉन्ड. ओके सो रिलेटिव नॉट बिटवीन टू कंपनीज बट रिलेटिव बिटवीन असेट्स. सो मैक्रो स्ट्रेटेजी का सारा फ्रेमवर्क ऐसा होता है कि दैट यू नो थ्रू द साइकिल यू कैन मूव फ्रॉम इक्विटी टू बॉन्ड इक्विटी टू क्रेडिट टू बॉन्ड एंड बैक टू इक्विटी टू क्रेडिट टू बॉन्ड यू नो. सो अगर आप इन्वेस्टिंग फ्रेमवर्क आपका इन एसेट एलोकेशन को फ्लिप करके और फ्रॉम वन असेट टू अनदर असेट यू नो इफ यू कैन मूव सक्सेसफुली एटलीस्ट मेरे एक्सपीरियंस में फॉर माई पर्सनल एंड फॉर पीपल हु आई एडवाइज that you know I we've been able to I think you will be able to extract more returns from markets versus just buy and hold or versus just at least I think if you do it successfully there is a tremendous space for you to outperform broader indices such as Nifty and S&P. okay, so I just wanted to sort of set a framework of how do you differentiate the two approaches of investing, which is top down and bottom up? I just want to sort of pause here, and I think after this rambling, you know, I think if Tarun, if you think that you know there is something that I should highlight sure. in terms of the dissimilarities and dissimilarities of this approach, we should do that, and then I'll move forward.
Yeah. So, Manish bhai, can you kickstart the discussion around various cycles in the market, which was our first poll question also, early cycle, mid cycle, and the late stage of the cycle. Can you give our attendees some view on what are these cycles, and maybe you can bring some historical perspective, Indian across globe. So those will be very good case studies for our viewers here.
Okay, so again, so I sort of right now, so far I explained the differences between two approaches. Now, macro strategy, the way I look at it, now this is a personal view, okay? There's no book on it, okay? But perhaps I'll have to write it, but I see macro investing through the lens of cycle framework that if you are an investor, you will experience early cycle, mid cycle, and late cycle in terms of, let's say, a very simplistic book, just equity investing or overall investing. Now, what are the early cycles all about? Early cycles are periods when hard data of economy is pretty bad, okay? Which basically means that the growth is decelerating. Some big crisis has happened. It could be banking crisis, ya fir corona crisis ho sakta hai. या फिर यू नो कोई एक्सोजनस शॉक हो गया है किसी पर्टिकुलर टेरिटरी में देश में तो उसकी वजह से अचानक से ग्रोथ डिसेलरेट होता है. इसको हार्ड डेटा बोलते हैं हम. इंडस्ट्रियल ग्रोथ हो जाए, पीएमआई हो जाए, क्रेडिट ग्रोथ डिसेलरेट हो जाता है, इन्वेस्टमेंट इंटेंशंस कम हो जाते हैं, कंज्यूमर सेंटिमेंट्स वीक हो जाते हैं. तो बेसिकली अर्ली साइकिल वो पीरियड होता है जिसके अंदर हार्ड डेटा सारा खराब हो जाता है, सेंटिमेंट्स खराब हो जाते हैं. लेकिन उस पीरियड में ऑफकोर्स इक्विटी मार्केट जो होता है वो जनरली लेवरेज ऑन ग्रोथ होता है. तो जब डेटा खराब हो जाता है तो आप इक्विटी मार्केट शार्पली डाउन करेक्ट हो जाता है. तो उस सेटअप में अक्सर क्या होता है इन द मार्केट बेस्ड इकोनॉमी दैट वी आर इन, अक्सर ये होता है कि दैट पॉलिसी मेकर्स लाइक इन इंडिया केस यू नो आरबीआई एंड गवर्नमेंट, इन यूएस केस इट्स फेड एंड ट्रेजरी, दे कम फॉरवर्ड टू पंप प्राइम द इकोनॉमी, है ना, कि भाई हमारी इकोनॉमी अगर वीकन हो रही है तो हम क्या करें. तो रेट्स नीचे लेके जाते हैं, यानी कि इंटरेस्ट रेट्स कम कर देते हैं, बड़ा फिस्कल स्टिमुलस दे देते हैं, कई सारे देशों के अंदर टैक्स कट्स और इस तरह की चीजें हो जाती है, डायरेक्टली चेक ट्रांसफर हो जाते हैं कंज्यूमर को. तो इस तरह की बहुत सारी चीजें की जाती है जिससे कि इकोनॉमी वापस रिवाइव हो, है ना. तो जब खराब डेटा से जब तक डेटा वापस इंप्रूव नहीं हो जाता तब तक सारे जो फिस्कल और मॉनेटरी अथॉरिटीज हैं वो मेहनत करते हैं इस बात के लिए कि चीजें ठीक हो जाए, है ना. तो इस पार्ट को अर्ली साइकिल बोला जाता है. तो बेसिकली सरप्राइजिंगली जो ऑफकोर्स इक्विटी में इन्वेस्ट करते हैं उनको पता है कि मोस्टली रिटर्न्स आर मेड इन बैड टाइम्स, है ना. returns are not made when newspapers are talking good stuff, and you know all the data which is coming to is to you is very good. Most of the good, big returns are made in times when actually news is very bad, but policymakers are leaning against the bad news. आप समझे मेरी बात की चीजें बहुत खराब है लेकिन आपकी जो गवर्नमेंट है और आपके जो सेंट्रल बैंकर्स हैं वो मेहनत कर रहे हैं कि चीजें ठीक हो जाए. तो उस पीरियड में आपको वैल्यूएशन भी सस्ता मिलता है और धीरे 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 रिस्क एपेटाइट आने की वजह से यू नो व्हेन मार्केट्स रीप्राइस ग्रोथ एंड रीप्राइस सेंटिमेंट्स अगेन, तो उस पीरियड के अंदर आपको इक्विटी मार्केट जो है वो सबसे ज्यादा गेन्स देता है ना. तो जैसे आपने बताया कि मतलब आई टर्न एक्सट्रीमली कंस्ट्रक्टिव एंड मार्च 2020 एंड सेम थिंग आई डिड इन 2014 अर्ली मिडल ऑफ 2013 कि चीजें बहुत खराब थी लेकिन इंक्रीमेंटली सारे एक्शन आरबीआई और गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया से इंडिया में और बाहर भी यू नो सेंट्रल बैंकर्स का जो इंक्रीमेंटल मूवमेंट था बाय ईजिंग रेट्स फिस्कल डेफिसिट बढ़ाना ये सब की वजह से चीजें अगले 6-8-12 महीने के अंदर नॉर्मलाइज हो गई. तो इस पीरियड के अंदर इक्विटी मार्केट में जब आप इन्वेस्ट करते हो तो आपको बहुत रिटर्न बनते हैं है ना. दिस आई कॉल इट्स रिफ्लेशन साइकिल. रिफ्लेशन का मतलब ये होता है रिफ्लेशन और इन्फ्लेशन में फर्क ये है कि इन्फ्लेशन तो हार्ड डेटा है. रिफ्लेशन वो पीरियड होता है जिसके अंदर आपके पॉलिसी मेकर्स विच इज सेंट्रल बैंक एंड गवर्नमेंट आर ट्राइंग हार्ड टू ब्रिंग द ग्रोथ बैक है ना. उसको रिफ्लेशन साइकिल बोलते हैं ना. सब क्या होता है कि इस पीरियड में अगर आप ओवरऑल पूरे साइकिल का इक्विटी का रिटर्न देखें यू नो तो सबसे पहले अर्ली साइकिल आता है फिर मिड साइकिल आता है जिसके अंदर गवर्नमेंट और आरबीआई थोड़ा सा टाइटन करना शुरू करते हैं लेकिन वो टेलीग्राफ्ड होता है. मतलब वो बता के करते हैं कि नहीं अब चीजें ठीक हो गई तो अब मेरे को इतना फिस्कल डेफिसिट करने की जरूरत नहीं है इतना खर्चा करने की जरूरत नहीं है मेरे को रेट सब काटने की जरूरत नहीं है. जैसे अब आरबीआई रेट थोड़ी काटेगा अब आरबीआई धीरे धीरे टाइटन करेगा लेकिन वो बता करके टाइटन करते हैं. जब वो बता के टाइटन करते हैं तो मार्केट को इतना फर्क नहीं पड़ता है. साथ साथ में क्या होने लगता है कि क्योंकि चीजें रिकवर हो गई है तो उसकी वजह से जो कंज्यूमर है जैसे आप लोग हैं वो आप लोगों को लगता है अब चीजें ठीक है कोरोना शायद चला गया है ओवरऑल इतना खराब नहीं है माहौल तो चलो घर खरीदते हैं. तो घर खरीदने के लिए आप लेवरेज करना शुरू करते हैं कि आप बैंक से लोन ले लेते हैं. सिमिलरली इंडस्ट्रियलिस्ट ऐसा बोलता है कि चलो केपेक्स करते हैं है ना. तो लेवरेज साइकिल जो है वापस शुरू होने लगता है. तो इस पीरियड को मैं बोलता हूँ जो मिड साइकिल होता है जिसके अंदर हालांकि आपकी जो इकोनॉमी में आउटसाइड ऑफ गवर्नमेंट सब लोग लेवरेज करना शुरू करते हैं तो उससे प्रॉफिट पूल बढ़ता है लेकिन पॉलिसी मेकर्स एक्चुअली आपके अगेंस्ट खड़े हो जाते हैं. बट उससे बहुत फर्क नहीं पड़ता है. उसका रीजन ये है कि क्योंकि लेवरेज साइकिल से प्रॉफिट पूल बढ़ता चला जाता है हालांकि गवर्नमेंट की पॉलिसी रिलेटिवली टाइट होती चली जाती है. तो इस पीरियड को मिड साइकिल बोलते हैं. उसका नाम जैसे मैंने अर्ली साइकिल को रिफ्लेशन साइकिल बोला मिड साइकिल वाला जो पीरियड होता है उसको मैं रीलेवरेज साइकिल बोलता हूँ जिसके अंदर कंज्यूमर और इंडस्ट्रीज वापस से लेवरेज करने लगते हैं और फाइनली हम वी एंटर इन अ लेट साइकिल. तो फिर क्या होता है कि लेट साइकिल वो पार्ट होता है जिसके अंदर इन्फ्लेशन आने लगता है वापस से. तो इन्फ्लेशन का मतलब क्या है? इन्फ्लेशन का मतलब है कि आपकी इकोनॉमी अब उस लेवल पे ग्रो कर रही है जिस लेवल पे हमारे पास में अब सप्लाई नहीं है, है ना. आपके एक एक बंबई में अगर आप कुल मिलाकर के जैसे 5,000 रूम्स हैं जो हम होटल के दे सकते हैं लेकिन किसी दिन अगर रोज दर रोज अगर 5,500 लोगों की डिमांड आ जाए तो क्या होगा? होटल के प्राइस जो है रेस्टोरेंट के प्राइजेस जो है हर चीज भयंकर बढ़ जाएंगी. तो उसको बोलते हैं हम इन्फ्लेशन. तब जब इन्फ्लेशन आता है तो एटलीस्ट मेरा बिलीफ ये है कि इवेंचुअली जो सारे पॉलिसी मेकर्स हैं आरबीआई हो या सेंट्रल बैंक सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट हो दे लीड अगेंस्ट इट. उसका रीजन ये है कि पिछले 50-100 सालों में जब जब जिस जिस देश में बहुत इन्फ्लेशन आया है तब तक बिजनेस साइकिल जो है वो शार्पली स्लो हो गया है. तो उसको कंटेन करना बहुत जरूरी है. अदरवाइज इन्फ्लेशन की वजह से क्या है सब कुछ हैराकिरी होने शुरू हो जाती है. अगर आप उसको कंटेन नहीं करोगे तो जो एंकरिंग होती है एक एवरेज आदमी की नहीं चलो मैं इन्वेस्ट करता हूं अभी यू नो मैं 50 करोड़ का इन्वेस्ट करता हूं क्योंकि मेरे दिमाग में है कि नहीं मैं इस भाव पे पैसा ले लूंगा और इस भाव पे कंज्यूमर को अगले 10 साल तक इस मशीन से जो पैदावार होगी वो बेच दूंगा. लेकिन अचानक से जब इन्फ्लेशन 10% हो गया 12% हो गया 15% हो गया तो आदमी का जो कैपिटल एलोकेशन फ्रेमवर्क है वो चेंज हो जाता है और वो एक्चुअली समहाउ बोथ कंज्यूमर एज वेल एज इंडस्ट्रीज बिगिन टू स्लो डाउन. तो उसको हम लेट साइकिल बोलते हैं. अब लेट साइकिल के अंदर क्या होता है कि इक्विटी में अर्ली साइकिल का उल्टा होता है. इस पीरियड के अंदर एक्चुअली आपको नुकसान होता है, आप यू नेट नेट एंड अप लूजिंग लॉट ऑफ मनी इन इक्विटी। उसका रीजन है कि पॉलिसी मेकर्स आपके अगेंस्ट खड़े हो गए हैं। अगेंस्ट खड़े हो गए हैं किसके लिए, क्योंकि जैसे कि आपका जो 5,500 लोगों का जो रूम का एपेटाइट आ गया है, अब उसको आपको गिरा करके 5,000 पे लेके जाना है, तो इसके लिए आपको रेट्स को टाइट करना पड़ेगा, इसके लिए आपको गवर्नमेंट का खर्चा कम करना पड़ेगा। लेकिन क्या होता है कि इकोनॉमी तो डायनेमिक सिस्टम है, तो इकोनॉमी में ऐसा कोई प्रिसाइज तरीका नहीं कि 5,500 की डिमांड जो हम 5,000 पे लेके चले जाए। इकोनॉमी में ऐसी कोई एग्जैक्टली ऐसा कोई टेक्निक नहीं है कि आप प्रिसाइसली डिमांड इक्वल टू सप्लाई कर दें। तो उसके लिए क्या है कि बिकॉज आप उल्टा खड़े हो जाते हैं, तो इन द एंड इवेंचुअली आपकी जो डिमांड है वो सप्लाई से भी नीचे चली जाती है, एंड वी एंटर इन सम फॉर्म ऑफ रिसेशन और स्लो डाउन, है ना। तो इस पीरियड को हम लेट साइकिल बोलते हैं। इसके सिम्टम्स हैं कि सबसे बड़ा सिम्टम तो है कि इन्फ्लेशन आने आ गया है बहुत ज्यादा, जो सरप्राइज कर रहा है आपको हायर साइड में। दूसरा सिम्टम है कि आपकी जो पॉलिसी मेकर्स हैं, लेट्स से इन इंडिया के अंदर RBI, US में फेड, यूरोप में ECB, वो लोग जो है वो रेट्स को टाइटन कर रहे हैं मोर देन व्हाट मार्केट्स आर एक्सपेक्टिंग। तो पॉलिसी सेटअप थोड़ा सा सॉर्ट ऑफ अगेंस्ट हो जाता है मार्केट का वर्सेस मार्केट एक्सपेक्टेशन, एंड उसकी वजह से इवेंचुअली स्लो डाउन होता है, एंड बिकॉज इक्विटी मार्केट्स वर नॉट एंटिसिपेटिंग इट, दे एंड अप एक्चुअली हैविंग अ बिग सेल ऑफ, एंड सो इस पीरियड के अंदर आप नुकसान करते हैं। तो ये तीन अलग अलग साइकिल हैं, अर्ली, मिड और लेट साइकिल, जिसको हम वापस से रिहर्स करने के लिए, पहले साइकिल को रिफ्लेशन साइकिल बोलते हैं, दूसरे को रीलेवरेज साइकिल बोलते हैं, और तीसरे को इन्फ्लेशन साइकिल बोलते हैं। अब क्या है कि ये तीनों जो है सीक्वेंस होते हैं हमेशा, हर साइकिल में पिछले 100 साल की हिस्ट्री उठा के देखेंगे, हर सब में ये तीनों साइकिल प्ले आउट इवेंचुअली होते ही हैं। ये हालांकि होते सीक्वेंस हैं, लेकिन एग्जैक्ट टर्म नहीं है, ऐसा नहीं है कि बहुत अर्ली साइकिल एग्जैक्टली 1.5 साल चलेगा, बट अर्ली साइकिल्स टिपिकली शॉर्ट टर्म होते हैं, मीनिंग जब एकदम व्हेन द मार्केट्स राइज फ्रॉम एशेज, यू नो, तो 1-1.5 साल के अंदर बहुत बड़ा रिटर्न बन जाता है। तो अब देखो कि आप 2009 हो जाए, 2013-14 के अंदर आप इन्वेस्ट कर दो, 2002-03 में इन्वेस्ट कर दो, या फिर 2020 में इन्वेस्ट कर दो, जब आप इक्विटी में इन्वेस्ट करते हो, खास करके स्मॉल कैप मिड कैप में, तो आपका 1-2 साल के अंदर पैसा ट्रिपल हो जाता है, वो अर्ली साइकिल का बात है। जब आप, लेकिन इसके लिए क्या है, इसमें सबसे बड़ा डिसिप्लिन इन्वेस्टिंग का ये है कि आपको पोजिशन साइजिंग करनी पड़ेगी ठीक से, यानी कि जब अर्ली साइकिल के अंदर जब आप इन्वेस्ट कर रहे हो, तो आप 5-10-15% इन्वेस्ट नहीं करने हैं, आपको सिग्निफिकेंट परसेंटेज ऑफ नेटवर्थ मार्केट्स में इन्वेस्ट करना पड़ेगा, एटलीस्ट अगर आप मैक्रो को फॉलो कर रहे हो। तो मिड साइकिल के अंदर आपको क्या करना पड़ेगा, क्योंकि आपके रिटर्न्स जो हैं, बहुत सारे रिटर्न्स आ चुके हैं, लेकिन आप लेट साइकिल में नहीं हो अभी भी, बॉन्ड्स के अंदर एक्चुअली नुकसान होगा क्योंकि इंटरेस्ट रेट्स ऊपर जाएंगी, तो इसलिए आपका, आप फिर भी अभी भी इक्विटी में ही रहोगे, लेकिन आप बेटा कम करोगे, यानी कि रिस्की असेट्स जो है जैसे स्मॉल और मिड कैप्स है उसमें से एग्जिट करोगे, और निफ्टी या फिर डाइवर्सिफाई करोगे, उसमें ऐड करोगे US मार्केट्स को, मे बी चाइनीज मार्केट को, मे बी यूरोपियन मार्केट को, बट एक थोड़ा सा डाइवर्सिफाइड लार्ज कैप ओरिएंटेड पोर्टफोलियो बनाओगे जिसका ओवरऑल रिस्क जो है स्मॉल कैप मिड कैप से कम हो। तो मोस्ट प्रॉब्ली हम उस साइकिल में हैं अभी। इस साइकिल के अंदर इतना एग्जूबरेंट मूवमेंट नहीं होता है और इतना एक्सेसिव रिटर्न्स नहीं बनता है। इक्विटी मोटा मोटी अगर आप थ्रू द साइकिल एकदम पैसिव इन्वेस्टर्स हो, तीनों साइकिल में आप हमेशा इन्वेस्ट करके रहो, तो आपको मोटा मोटी 5-7% के आसपास में बॉन्ड के ऊपर पैसा मिलता है ना। अगर बॉन्ड इंडिया के अंदर अभी 7% के आसपास एवरेज ट्रेड होगा, अगर 10 साल का बॉन्ड, गवर्नमेंट बॉन्ड, तो आपका एक्सपेक्टेशन ये होना चाहिए कि मैं 12-14% के बीच में, अगर मैं निफ्टी में हमेशा इन्वेस्टेड रहूंगा, तो इतना बनाओगे, उससे ज्यादा नहीं बनाओगे इफ यू आर पैसिव इन्वेस्टर, है ना। इफ बॉन्ड नीचे आएगा तो अकॉर्डिंगली निफ्टी के अंदर भी रिटर्न उतना ही नीचे चला जाएगा, है ना, क्योंकि इसको, इस चीज को बोलते हैं इक्विटी रिस्क प्रीमियम, कि इक्विटी जो है वो एक फाइनेंशियल इंस्ट्रूमेंट है बॉन्ड की तरह से, फिक्स डिपॉजिट की तरह से, ज्यादा वोलेटाइल है, लेकिन आप अगर लॉन्ग टर्म के अंदर, अगर निफ्टी जैसे इंस्ट्रूमेंट के अंदर इन्वेस्टेड रहोगे, तो मोटा मोटी आपको 5-7% का रिटर्न बनेगा। लेकिन ये 5-7% का जो रिटर्न है वो डिस्ट्रीब्यूटेड है, इवनली डिस्ट्रीब्यूटेड नहीं है। अर्ली साइकिल के अंदर आपको शायद 50% एक्स्ट्रा मिल जाएगा, मिड साइकिल में आपको 3-4% ही शायद मिलेगा एक्स्ट्रा ओवर बॉन्ड, और लेट साइकिल में आपको शायद 25-30-40% का बॉन्ड के बनिस्पत नुकसान हो जाएगा। तो मैं जस्ट टू कंक्लूड कि यू शुड हैव मैक्सिमम पोजीशन इन अर्ली साइकिल, यू शुड बी समवॉट अंडरवेट इक्विटी बाय वे ऑफ यू नो रिड्यूसिंग द स्मॉल कैप मिड कैप एंड ओनली इन्वेस्टिंग थ्रू निफ्टी एंड सच लाइक, एंड देन इन द लेट साइकिल यू शुड ट्राई एंड डू नेगेटिव बेटा, विच इज एक्चुअली दैट आप इक्विटीज निकल करके 10 साल के पीएसयू बॉन्ड में या फिर 10-15 साल के गवर्नमेंट बॉन्ड में चले जाए. एक्चुअली उस पीरियड लेट साइकिल में जब आप बॉन्ड में इन्वेस्ट करते हैं लॉन्ग बॉन्ड्स के अंदर, तो जब इक्विटी गिर रहा होता है तो बॉन्ड एक्चुअली बढ़ रहा होता है. तो उस पीरियड के अंदर भी यू मे एंड अप एक्चुअली मेकिंग एब्सोल्युटली पॉजिटिव एंड सब्सटेंशियल रिटर्न, है ना. तो इस तरह से जस्ट टू कंक्लूड, इफ यू हैव अ वे, एंड वी शुड डिस्कस हाउ एग्जैक्टली डू वी डू इट, बट इफ यू हैव अ वे टू फाइंड आउट दैट वी आर इन अर्ली साइकिल, पुट मोस्ट ऑफ योर मनी इन स्मॉल एंड मिड कैप. इफ यू आर कॉशन दैट इट्स मिड साइकिल, देन यू शुड पुट मोस्ट ऑफ योर मनी इन लार्ज कैप ओरिएंटेड निफ्टी एंड सच इंडाइसेस एंड मेबी म्यूचुअल फंड that Tarun and all sort of suggest. And if you know that you are in late cycle, then you should put most of your money, like in my case, I get out completely from equity and put most of my money in long bonds, you know, through income funds or buying the 10-year PSU bond directly. So this is how I would manage my money. And perhaps, you know, some part of your portfolio can be allocated basis this framework.
So, Manish bhai, I think we hear you, but I think it's a very, very difficult thing to implement, right? And I think the noise around the entire fund management industry, if I talk about, or the entire media around the capital markets, which talks about, it has been completely tilted towards a very long-term equity investing philosophy, right? Yes. So, don't you feel what you just mentioned is a completely different approach, and which may be very difficult to practice for a normal investor. So maybe you want to highlight for a normal investor how a approach like yours could be a meaningful one. You want to share some data in terms of performance, how this has been given a better performance compared to a buy and hold strategy.
So if an investor is unassisted, okay, I mean, someone is a shopkeeper or running an industry and has no clue and no one like you to sort of help, okay, and to identify what stage of cycle we are in, okay, because this is a, like bottom-up investing, this is also a full-time job, okay, that all the time you're trying to understand what part of cycle we are in, okay, how exactly policymakers are going to respond, how bad or good the inflation outcome is. Okay, all of these things, along with, of course, geopolitics and many other things which are long-term in nature, all of them have to be calibrated every day, every minute, throughout the months and years, you know, to understand what part of cycle we are in. So if, you know, but who said that investing is easy, right? You know, which is why, you know, there are people like you who are also deploying themselves completely to help investors in the end, you know, for business, of course, but that we will tell you how exactly to allocate. Now, how does a normal investor do it? You know, normal investor, if I assume that he is an investor because he has surplus capital, right? But he is not an investor because he is trying to identifying opportunity himself. So I'm imagining that the normal investor's definition is the one who has surplus capital, but he is not in the business of investing. You know, if you are in the business of investing, no issue, you know, then let's discuss it. It's not a very difficult task. You know, if you put a lot of time in it, you know, you'll begin to understand today or 5 years or 10 years later, how exactly you do the macro investing, precisely the way you do the bottom up investing. Bottom up investing is also pretty hard, you know, which company to buy, whether how that company has actually behaved over the last 20 years, whether that management is actually too greedy, whether the corporate governance standards of that firm is actually good or bad, whether the industry that it is operating in is actually the sunrise or sunset industry, whether the microeconomic policies of the government are favorable to that industry or in the company or no, and the region that it is operating in, the access to capital, access to raw material, all of these things is the playbook of bottom-up investor. You have to know everything to put in your money in capital. Now, if you're a bottom-up investor, you will end up doing this. You know, if you're wanting to buy Mundra Port, okay, then you will have to understand Adani, their management styles. You'll have to go to Mundra Port. You'll have to sort of look at 20 other ports, the competitive or comparative advantage that Mundra Port offers, the contracts that they have signed, and then try and sort of put all of this on Excel and then, you know, put a framework to it, is exactly how the cash flows of Mundra Port will play out. Right? And then finally, actually, at certain discount yield, you discount the cash flows and understand that, okay, the Mundra Port's valuation today versus what your expectation is, cheap or expensive. And accordingly, you take a call on Mundra Port, right? That's the approach you do if you're an investor. But a normal investor does not do that. Normal investor goes to Tarun and say that, okay, I've got this, you know, 50 lakhs or 5 crore or 50 crores of excess capital, surplus, and I want to invest in. So tell me what is that I can do about it. And, you know, Tarun says that, okay, Tarun is a bottom-up investing framework guy. So he says, okay, I think, you know, let's put 70% of your money in equity. Of that, let's say 80% of that actually goes to Nifty or large cap funds. 20-30% can go to, because Tarun likes commodities right now, so he puts in commodity. So that's the, so they are, he, the investor is getting intermediated by Tarun, isn't it? Similarly, Tarun can do also. So this is more for you, Tarun, than for the audience, because you should be able to offer to your client, to your normal investor, that, hey, you got this 50 crores surplus capital. Now, for most parts, I actually allocate capital for you by investing in certain kind of funds and fund managers that Tarun thinks is going to do well. But then there is also an alternate approach. And that alternate approach that I discussed at length in the beginning is macro investing. Now, the beauty, as far as Tarun is concerned, you are agnostic, right? You can look at both bottom up and top down. You're not like me. You know, I am all in top down and all in macro, but Tarun is not all in, right? So what Tarun will say that, look, I know, I will say that 20% of my risk capital or equity capital or the capital of the investor, I'll actually route through a macro investing framework. Okay. What will it do for your investor? And you, this is the part that you have to convince your investor, that surprisingly, the outcome for the investor or for this particular portfolio, which is macro investing portfolio, can one end up being substantially better than bottom up. But that's not the real kick. The real kick, Tarun, is that, you know, for your investor, the overall correlation and the risk of the portfolio will actually go down, because, you know, you are accessing market through a different approach. Sure. This is precisely what you're doing when you are actually putting your investors' money in five different fund houses. Because what are you trying to do? That you are trying to do that, okay, you know, this fellow actually behaves in a certain fashion and another fellow behaves in certain other fashion. So I will actually put my money across these two or three or four so that my overall returns, I get alpha from each of them in some form or other, but overall my risk actually goes down. So yeah, to that extent, your Sharpe ratios go up, you know, the risk adjusted returns go up. Okay. So similarly, the macro framework, actually, once you put that in the system, and 20-30%, 40%, depending upon how your investor is okay with, you know, once you do that, you know, the correlations will come down, the overall beta of the portfolio will come down, and therefore you will actually, for the normal investor that you refer to, you will end up out delivering for him better returns, perhaps with sort of in aggregate terms, less risk. Okay, so just to conclude here, while it appears complicated, you know, given that, you know, we had only 20 minutes of conversation in terms of how you do it, but then, a normal investor doesn't have to do it. All that you have to do, Tarun, is to explain to the normal investor that, you know, versus a bottom-up investing, you know, that 10 other fund managers are doing, Tarun will do this a little bit of a macro investing. Now, Tarun can do it, you know, what do you mean by macro investing is, you know, all that you have to do is that take a call on bonds versus equity, you know, and then say that for this 20% of your capital, sometimes I'll be all into a small cap fund, sometimes all into Nifty ETF, and sometimes all into PFC, REC, and ABARD, and 10-year corporate bond, you know. So this is how I'll move your money. And in the end, I am very confident that, you know, you, for your investor, the net outcome will be substantially better.
Sure. Brilliant. So one question which may come to many investors' mind, that isn't there is a chance to for an investor to miss out the so-called multi-baggers or compounders through the bottoms-up stock picking, as they're called, they are set and defined entry and exit based on some macro indicators. So let's say I take example of Bajaj Finance, right? I have been part of that story from last 10 years. I have seen that stock from 500 rupees. As we talk, it's a 8,000 rupees stock. So what is your suggestion? Is the macro approach also helps us in identify such multi-baggers in the portfolio, or it is more driven out of indexing?
Yeah. You know, the beauty, I mean, while, you know, in every index, you know, you'll have some stocks doing excessively well and some others actually being duds. You know, this is the marketing gimmick of sorts, you know, of portfolio managers, PMSs, fund managers, fund houses and whatnot, is to actually highlight that, that hey, there is a trick of actually multiplying your money by 50 times, you know, through something like, as you said, Bajaj Finance, you know, moving from 500 to 7,500. But the thing is that never ever sort of look at any story through the lens of a particular stock. Always look at the story of the portfolio of an individual. Now, if you like Rakesh Jhunjhunwala as an investor, or you like a fund house as a portfolio manager, you know, don't sort of let him tell you that, look, I invested in this thing and, you know, it went up by 50 times. Always ask this question that what did your portfolio do? Okay. You know, because this makes a great story, you know, it actually attracts you, you know, that, wow, you know, this guy was able to identify Bandhan or Bajaj Finance or, you know, Bharti or XYZ, you know, some of the specialty chemicals and there are like 50 times, 100 times. But then, you know, when you look at the portfolio level, you end up seeing that, you know, they are barely sort of doing as much as Nifty. Some of them, you know, barely doing like small cap, mid cap oriented funds, actually doing barely as much as indices. Now, what's the problem in that? The problem is that there is no way, even for the most prescient and the greatest fund manager to identify too many multi-baggers as a percentage of overall portfolio, to the extent that, you know, they outdo indices for sustained period of time substantially. And which is why, as a matter of fact, unfortunately, 80%, 90% of the funds, you know, somewhere between 70 to 90% of funds across territories, not just in India, across territories, including US, where which is a mothership for fund management industry, fund managers actually underperform indices. And I'm not talking about fund managers, meaning traditional fund houses, okay? I'm talking of hedge funds. I'm talking of PMS guys, AIF, you know, all the greatness of, you know, this marketing gimmickry of sorts, you know, that you see on TV and YouTube, where people are eloquently talking about so many great things about how great stories they were able to pick up. Once you sort of go down and look at the portfolio performance, you know, you realize that the successful one could outdo indices, but only marginally, sometimes 1-3% more than Nifty. So, but most of them end up actually under-delivering indices. So, which is why I'm putting a little bit of a caution here that, that you know, there is a great kick in thinking that you can make a lot of money by identifying, you know, Bitcoin or Bajaj Finance. The idea is that it's very likely that for your capital, you know, because you are an evolved investor, you know for sure that for every multi-bagger, there is also a risk of ruin. Meaning that there are, for every one multi-bagger, there are 2, 3, 4 who actually go down dramatically, okay? Which actually even out the overall performance, and you end up actually delivering only as much as indices, or somewhat better than indices, or somewhat worse than indices, you know? So portfolio performance, Tarun, is very different than that of stock performance. And this is what you should all bother about. Never bother about the stories being sort of sold to you. I mean, I being a fund manager telling you the secret of it, that don't ever give in and pay too much attention to a story, because that's, you know, like, you know, movies when they get sold to you, okay? What they show you in the trailer, okay? They show you the best scenes in the trailer. But when you watch the movie, you know, that is like 10% of the movie. The 90% is different, right? That's a little bit of slow moving stuff, you know, story woven around the trailer, okay? So don't go by the trailer. Go by the full movie, which is again not bad, you know. and outperforming Nifty for 1-2% is great stuff, but that's all. You know, I don't know anyone who actually replicated at a portfolio level performance of Bajaj Finance, even 25% of Bajaj Finance. Okay. I don't know anyone. And all the sort of marquee investors, you know, all this data is there out in public. I'm not talking of just fund managers. All the marquee investors who are very eloquent, you know, who actually talk the super bullish tones on CNBCs and whatnot. Actually, there is a way to assess their own performance. You will be surprised that all the sort of super investors have barely outperformed Nifty and such like. Okay, so again, to conclude, there is a sensational bit out there. But that's a little bit of a marketing gimmick. And this is the right way to do it, right? As a movie sells its trailer. And similarly, the fund managers and the big bulls actually sell their the best performing assets, but don't talk about the ruins that they've had. But again, this is not about being critical to them. It is simply about that ex ante, meaning before the event, there is absolutely no way to know whether Bajaj Finance and L&T Finance will have such a different prognosis in 2010. There is no way to know. Okay. Very difficult to know, rather. There are some people who would have got this right, but only to the extent that, you know, it became, let's say, 5%, 10% of their portfolio. Okay. So in a sense, that would still mean that some portfolio who had the 10% in Bajaj Finance versus L&T Finance, they would have done much better. But yet that does not mean that the overall performance of the portfolio is as much as Bajaj Finance, because that will still be a 10%. No, I mean, again, to give you an analogy, that if you're buying any business, let's say if you're a shopkeeper, you know, you always want to, you know, while there is a lot of footfalls from a particular colony coming to you, or you are any salesman you are, you know, and you sort of are selling some stuff in Vishakhapatnam, what is there in your mind all the time? Can I also sell it to Delhi and Bombay also, just to sort of ensure that my portfolio is more diversified, just in case Vishakhapatnam goes down, I still end up doing all right. Okay. So in a sense, portfolio approach is what you should think for yourself as well as for others. And this is why I would say, my performance is not the thing that I myself don't know whether I'll be able to replicate, but I've been able to sort of significantly outperform for myself, okay, by investing through this macro approach, significantly been able to outperform the indices and, you know, most fund houses and fund managers for myself. Whether I'll be able to do it for many investors who are actually now working with me, I'm not sure. But okay, I'm just sort of giving you an alternate approach by not promising you that you'll make 10% more than Nifty. I'm simply telling you that there is a possibility of actually earning Nifty or Nifty plus returns. But the real attraction that I'm telling you is that my approach will actually reduce the drawdowns, meaning the losses. Because when you are out in the end cycle, you do not experience the 25, 30, 40, 50% drop that, you know, Nifty tends to have, you know, every now and then, or any stock tends to have, you know, what has happened to, let's say, IRCTC. You know, people would have given the same story on IRCT, but what's happened opposite and again will happen opposite, you know, on Monday. So basically, my idea is that, you know, but if you can reduce the drawdown at a portfolio level, you may end up actually delivering as much in, or substantially more than Nifty, you know, by an alternate approach, so to say.
Sure. So, Manish bhai, I think you spoke about diversification. And I remember while chatting with you, and I see it every day. We Indians are completely home biased, right? Our investments are completely India biased. And we definitely try our investors to diversify out of India. But as we speak, I don't see more than 10-15% of our portfolio is outside India. So maybe you want to bring in some systematic approach of global investing, and how do we build more conviction around that global investing? Now we have LRS, we have a lot of global mutual funds available to participate in this. So maybe from a diversification point of view, there is a geographical diversification one can do. One can style diversification, top down, bottoms up, and all that. So maybe you want to throw some light on geographical and any example you can give for US investor investing into emerging market or Japanese investor investing in US and India, how it has made a difference and how do you change the mind? Because this is investing is behavior, right? And the investor behavior is not correct. They only think India is the only place they can make money. So how do you change that?
So then there are two steps. You know, I think the most important thing is that, you know, folks like you who've been able to convince a lot of investors over the last 10, 20 years is that equity is not punting. Equity is not lottery. Equity is an asset class. You tend to earn a certain amount of risk premium in equity, and that you've been able to explain to them, and which is why we are having, 8,000-10,000 crore monthly flows. Okay. And from small places, small amounts, you know, people are coming because somehow as an industry, mutual fund or otherwise, we've been able to convey this message that don't consider equity as punting or a lottery. Now, that was a great job done by all of us, right? More specifically from people like you who've been actually been able to do this as a ground of work. Now the next job for you is to actually educate investors. You know, this question was asked from someone like, you know, Junjunwala, that, you know, why don't you look at the US? And he says that mere ghar mein khana itna achha hai, so why do I look look outside? Now, it works for him, maybe. But again, as an investor, you know, let's look at the fact checks, okay? That, you know, something like US markets in 10 years, of course, have done dramatically better than India, okay? That does not mean that US will continue to do well as well. But it simply means that there's a better food in some other kitchen, okay, or some other restaurant. And so just be aware of it, number one, that, you know, this food, which is called equity, is served in 180 countries, okay? Some countries serve this well, some countries don't serve it too well. Exactly what you're doing at home, that you are identifying one fund versus another, or you're identifying one style versus another. There are, you know, there is a choice to be made between one country versus another, okay? So that is a conviction that you ought to have, Tarun, first. Once you are convinced, and many people like you, and I know that you are aware of all this, but many of you are convinced, you will be able to convince this to people. In the end, the experience actually will mean, if they actually get reasonable experience, eventually will mean that people will be willing to invest abroad, okay? So, and this is not a new thing. Everywhere, you know, from Malaysia to US to Japan, every country, you know, rich folks actually go outside. Not because their food is not good, just because they understand the idea of diversification. They understand that certain other kitchens are maybe serving better food. Certain other economies may be actually doing more vibrantly. Certain other systems may be delivering better profits and so on and so forth. You know, you can't play a tech cycle by not investing in US, okay? You can't play a luxury cycle by not investing in, what do you call it, Europe. And you can't play a consumer cycle of the world by not investing in China, okay? So as a matter of fact, you know, China is a better consumer, US is a better tech guy, and Europe is a better luxury producer, so to say, okay? So if that is the case, once I, as they say, that once the whole world is my family, I will begin to look around and actually look at opportunities across, independent of where I come from, you know. So I think, you know, this is a process. Every country has home bias. As I keep telling you and many people that, you know, how many people sitting in Jalandhar will actually go and buy land in Chennai, you know. Most of people end up buying land in and around Jalandhar only because that is what they know. It is the job of an advisor like you to actually, and fund managers like me, to sort of explain to people that no, you know, Jalandhar land prices are too high and therefore you must diversify and sort of buy something in Udaipur or buy something in Chennai, okay? Because relatively they are better place. This also sort of eliminates one fund manager that why the hell I'm sort of paying so much price in my country just because there are very few plays in that particular sector, you know? The sort of crazy valuations in staples in India or some of the specialty chemicals in India, once you sort of you broaden your framework, you may find that, okay, there are companies in Germany, the companies in sort of China, similar businesses, bigger catchment area, actually available at half the price, even below, right? So in a sense, by doing so, you can actually reduce the overall risk of your portfolio, okay? So, okay, there are many steps to it. let's first educate investors that, you know, there are more kitchens serving this food called equity or anything else. Let's understand those markets, identify, you know, we can't go to all 180 countries. So maybe Tarun's job will be that, okay, let me understand China, Japan, US and Europe. Okay, these four territories, you know, I will not look at sort of Indonesia and this and that, you know, I just focus on these four because India is a reasonable proxy for me as far as emerging market is concerned. And then try and build a bouquet of portfolios, you know, which has a sort of small or large amount of international portfolio, depending upon, you know, how rich you are, you know, richer you are. Okay. Again, as a motherhood statement, more as a percentage of your portfolio should be outside, because richer you are, it is your duty to your riches that, you know, they are well diversified, you know. Yeah. If you're very poor, I mean, then you don't have to bother about investing. If you have a 50 lakh rupees invested in market, you don't bother. Okay. Put money in Nifty and forget about it. But if you've got 100 crores, 500 crores, 1,000 crores invested in market, now you cannot run emerging market risk by putting all your money in, what do you call it, one market call, even though you come from India, you know. There is no patriotism in this, you know, that I'll put all my money. Exactly what you do. I mean, even if you know that, you know, this particular company called Bajaj Finance will do very well, you'll not put all your 1,000 crore in Bajaj Finance, right? You'll diversify. So I think, you know, I think this is a part of education, Tarun, and I think we'll all take this. I'm 100% confident that, you know, amongst the richest of Indians, you know, very large percentage of the portfolio in 5, 10, 20 years would start to be outside India. You know, can it be 20%? Can it be 40%? Depends upon how they taste the success of various markets, but they will start to be. Again, I just want to sort of remove this illusion. Indian markets are not doing independently well. You know, they're doing well along with many others, you know, as they've done always, right? Sometimes you do somewhat better, sometimes you do somewhat worse. But the thread of equity investing actually runs past pretty much all economies, you know. All the boats get lifted most of the times together. And all the boats actually, like in COVID, India fell by 35%. But wonder of wonder, pretty much all other markets fell by 30 to 40%, right? So it's not a big deal. But just because you are now diversified, overall, sometimes, you know, when unique risks are playing out in India, let's say India, the taper, post-taper 2013, the unique risk played out. In India, 2011-12, you know, unique risk of inflation played out. Policy paralysis played out. The 1998-99, the Vajpayee era, atom bomb related sort of risk played out in India. All of these are unique risks. You can, by diversifying across territories, you can reduce that risk, you know. And therefore, you may end up experiencing same or better return, but reduce risk in your portfolio.
So I think we are running out of time, but we will try in next 15-20 minutes to take some questions. So folks, yeah. My request is everybody start typing in your questions. So we have a person like Manish giving his perspective. So please make the most of this opportunity. So my next question, Manish bhai, is more on the macro indicators. And I remember you always talking about these 8-10 indicators like real rates, central bank actions, USD INR changes, global tax policy. And you told me that templatizing them and giving them a color or giving them some kind of high, mid, low kind of ranges will always give you a very clear-cut indication of this early, mid, or the late cycle. So maybe you want to give in the current context, on the current outlook part, where do you see all these 7-8 indicators right now? And maybe you can be more specific about India. And maybe as a takeaway, the investors, what should they do? And I know you are very bullish on farmland. I heard you in many channels talking about investing into farmland and real estate. So maybe you want to touch upon something. What is the unique opportunity available out there right now?
Yeah, so as far as sort of indicators are concerned, you know, I mean, we've discussed about many things and I do not want to bore people with all the indicators, but broadly, what I do is that about the few of them, I try and lighten them up with green, amber, and green and red to simply comprehend exactly, because there is not going to be, you know, all indicators sort of telling you whether it's an end cycle, mid cycle. Like, you know, in today's context, you know, we are just about to have a sort of credit growth picking up. Investment intentions are actually improving. The growth has recovered. The industrial production actually now is in sort of positive territory and doing fairly well. So all of these sort of seem to hint that we are in mid-cycle, okay? But then, you know, there are late cycle things also playing out, infiltrating in this mid-cycle, which is like exuberance amongst investors in terms of, you know, what they're doing. Little bit of a dollar story that, you know, dollar actually is ceasing to depreciate significantly, which is again a risk-on indicator. The yield curves are actually across the board, more specifically to US, but also in many other OECD countries are actually flattening, which is again a hint that markets are now pricing in policy mistakes by Fed and many other central bankers. Policies across emerging markets now, say Russia, Brazil, many other emerging markets are actually surprising on the higher tightening side, so to say. Even in US to a certain extent, I think, you know, rates have, policies have surprised on the tightening side, which is why the 2 years have you know, gone up quite substantially. Then China sort of credit impulse, you know, had been slowing, which is a lead industrial cycle indicator of sorts. So in a sense, while there are many mid-cycle plays right now, but there are many hints of that, you know, it could be becoming a little bit of a late cycle. So purely from market point of view, Tanun, while I think that we are in mid-cycle, there are hints that, you know, this mid-cycle can be shortened or compressed one. Precisely what happened in 2009-10, okay? Then, you know, whole of the early, mid and late cycle got compressed in less than 2 years. What if it's something similar, you know, that March 2020 we started, and March 2022, you know, we finish the whole cycle and therefore we enter the late cycle and lose a lot of money. That's not my base case right now, but let's continue to, in mid-cycle, your most important job, at least as a macro investor, is to continue to look at the exit door. Just in case the late cycle is playing out, you ought to reduce the overall risk in the portfolio. Remember, as I said, in early cycle, it's all about small and mid-cap or high beta. In mid-cycle, it's all about, again, India-centric investor, it's all about Nifty. And in late cycle, it's all about 10-year PSU bond, you know. So that's the way you sort of navigate three parts of the cycle. I still don't think we have entered a late cycle, but then there are many symptoms of late cycle appearing on the horizon. So keep a very close eye on a lot of these things. And we can continue to discuss about this many times in the future and, you know, figure out whether we are already entered late cycle. If we are entering in late cycle, then my recommendation to would be, see, I'm very clear right now, no small and mid cap right now. Okay. But whether you should be completely out of Nifty, S&P 500 and such likes also will be determined with if this inflation genie continue to persist and to the extent that, you know, central bankers and other policymakers, you know, begin to surprise you on much tighter side, shrinking the whole cycle, you know, too fast, too soon. Okay. So that's the way I would sort of approach investing in the current time frame. Now, as far as the farmland is concerned, just as it's a tangential conversation, but I think that, you know, because inflation is a chief risk today, Tarun, surprisingly, farmland, if you look at long-term track record of it, actually does a reasonable job in actually saving you from inflation. Because inflation invariably, especially in the food inflation, you know, the farm prices actually go up, and in fact more when the food prices or energy prices begin to grow up. Okay, so a legitimate instrument, you know, see, there are a lot of gold bucks and such like, you know, because gold is a favorite asset class of many people. Farm actually end up delivering much better than gold through the cycle with a lot of, you know, downside protection. You know, gold is a lot of volatility. You know, gold's volatility is as much as equity and returns are much lower than equity. So which is why I think, you know, after some research that I did over the last few months, I realized that one, it's a good protection to inflation. Two, it's a real asset class in a sense that over a long period of time, it actually does a reasonable job in overall, you know, delivering better than, of course, bonds. Sometimes very much better than equity, sometimes much worse than equity. But yeah, but they have a lot of downside protection in a sense that the drawdowns don't happen in farm investing. So to that extent, again, finally, on the valuation point of view, though I don't care much about it, but valuations for the farmland as of today is actually cheaper than, hello? They have been cheaper than at any point in time since 2004, especially versus financial assets, both bonds and equity. So to that extent, my advice to many investors is that look around for some farmland Of course, you need to protect yourself from encroachment and stuff like that. But I think, you know, it can be a reasonably cheap asset class, so to say, today, especially in the context that, you know, there is almost a sort of a revolution playing out in agricultural businesses in India, and both productivity as well as farm prices will actually ensure that the farmland yields actually go up. So I'm quite bullish on farmland, Chief. Just a second. Yeah.
Talking about, yeah.
Yeah. Yes. Carry on. I can hear.
Yeah. Talking about avenues in farmland, I think that's a very unorganized industry. And I think in terms of buying for a normal investor, it's a very difficult one. So maybe any quasi route you can give, which could be more organized way to play that story?
So basically there are some people and we can discuss offline, but you know, there are a lot of incubators and a lot of actually people doing the agri tech, okay, of sorts. And I think, you know, we can discuss this separately, but I mean, I'm going to invest in one of the agri-tech fund, which is being launched. But yeah, I am bullish on agriculture and basically to protect myself from inflation, I'm looking at farmland. But agri-tech is one such way, you know, you can sort of invest in as a proxy.
Sure. So there are some questions coming up. We will quickly take these questions. So Vijay has a question, which cap we should invest now, mid or large cap, which equity sector still has scope for investment, what investors should do in the third stage cycle. So Vijay, I will try to address these questions as Manish has very clearly mentioned that you should invest more in large cap today than mid cap today because he feels some bit of froth building in the small cap side. Which equity sector still has scope for investor? According to him, the index linked or Nifty large cap oriented has better scope. And what investors should do in the third stage, he mentioned that bonds are the preferred route. Right, Manish bhai?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, I'm surprised that that's how it is.
Yes. Are we in the initial phase of Indian residential real estate? I know you have been a very big critic of real estate for a long time now. I know you don't like buying your own house also. And I have taken that as a real example to stay away. But there are a lot of social stigma attached with the Indian mindset, right? So what do you want to share right now? Is it a time to buy real estate, buy property?
Absolutely. So I have reversed my call. I mean, 2013, you know, I sort of went live with this call that, you know, it's time to get out of real estate because real estate was, there was an exuberance there. Again, you know, I mean, you don't need a fund manager to tell you that in 2012, 13, there was something crazy going on. You know, exactly what's going on in small cap right now was going around 2013. So, you know, a lot of these things sort of, you know, this English and the conversations sort of seem to suggest that it's a very complex exercise, but any onlooker actually can see, Tarun, that, you know, can see that something wrong is going on, you know. I mean, it's not very difficult to imagine what's going wrong with IRCTC, you know, calling it a platform company and actually pricing it the valuation that it is, or it's what's going on in some of the new tech ventures, you know. I mean, look at the valuations of Nykaa and stuff like that, you know. So it's, you know, as an investor, okay, what I mean is that markets are like oceans, okay, and all kind of people can come and drink water, you know, from it, you know, and I don't want to drink all the water, okay, of the ocean. So I'll take my mudki and take my water and go home, okay. So again, this whole thing of top down, micro, macro, bottom up, all these are different styles to sort of take your water and go home. So I'm saying just a common sense approach would have told you that the Indian real estate was crazily overvalued in 2013, you know. So I put out a extensive sort of framework out in public that, you know, why I think real estate is expensive. Anyone, even my dad or you would have seen that, yeah, it's so expensive, you know. And there was nothing so great happening in India that, you know, suddenly prices were going up 20% every year. And then, you know, it's been 7 years, 8 years since then, you know, markets, real estate prices have, you know, barely moved, you know, in real terms, actually, they have gone down. Now, I think I'm reversing that call. And I made this point many times over the last few months that real estate is cheaper than financial assets in India. Okay. Both bonds as well as equity. So, which is why I tell everyone that if you have surplus capital, the first thing you should buy now is home. Okay. Is because, you know, of course, that gives you a lot of safety and all that is separate, but it is cheaper today than financial instruments, just the reverse of what it was in 2013. So I agree with, you know, the commentator there that residential real estate is cheap, and we most probably will enter a bull cycle, which tend to last for 6-7 years. So if we're starting in 2021 or 22, I don't know, but for good 5-6 years, you know, I think that, you know, real estate will do reasonably well.
Sure. I think another question is, since there is going to be corporate leverage phase, can the banks perform due to credit cycle revival in spite of being neutral on equities?
So come again. I didn't hear that.
So since there is going to be a corporate leverage phase, can the banks perform due to the credit cycle revival in spite of being neutral on equities?
So no, banks are sort of local economy plays, while you, I'm not suggesting that you should be neutral on equities in a sense that zero equity, you know, neutral on equity means indexizing the equity exposure instead of going for, you know, unique and small cap, mid cap bets, you know, but I agree with you that India actually, you know, I've said this many times, and you know, some of the links I can share with you, but if I think of 10, 15 years, India offers humongous opportunity, okay, for a long-only investor who doesn't want to navigate market through buy and sell and stuff like that, you know, just put money in large cap funds on Nifty and forget about it. And I think you'll do very well, because I think India's demographics and debt both are favorably positioned. And I think we will do pretty well over the next 10, 15 years. So to that extent, even banks will do very well. I think there is a significant space for the banks and corporates to re-lever, especially corporates who've gone through a little bit of a deleverage cycle over the last 6-7 years, especially after 2015. So, but I agree with that point that there is a possibility that if the corporate leverage cycle picks up again, you know, there is an opportunity in the banking. Now, the problem is that, you know, each industry has its own challenges. Now, banking is now being a challenge dramatically, in a dramatic fashion, by tech, okay, in India and abroad. And so the onset of the payment structures that we have now, the fintechs, and a little bit of a hint of CBDCs, which I mean central bank digital currencies, and you know, banks becoming bankless or branchless, so to say, with account aggregators coming in. So the way the banking is done, Tarun, and for the gentleman that you are or lady who asked this question, the whole banking space is actually getting disrupted. And therefore, my advice to everyone would be that don't take this active call on any particular bank at least, okay? Because you don't know whether the winner is going to be ICICI Bank or HDFC or Axis or you know, none of these and someone else, maybe perhaps SBI. So I think the best approach of investing is this unsolicited advice to the person who asked actually a different question, that don't access banking through a bank, but access bank through index. Okay, that's number one. Be aware that the profit pool of the banking can actually shrink as a percentage of economy if the fintechs and along with account aggregators actually disrupt the whole business, and the big tech begins to sort of play a significant part. You know, especially what has happened in, let's say, China, if that begins to play out. Given that India's tech adoption is actually quite reasonable, you know, especially what you've seen in UPI and such stuff like that. So be aware that you don't put too much of your money in banking again, okay? So again, going back to all of this, you know, irrespective of the view that you have, you know, you must diversify. And if you are actually do not want to take these active risks, just put money in Nifty equal weight or Nifty or BSE 200 and forget about it, because all of these churns, you know, if you can actively track them, enter and exit is fine. If you don't want to do it, then, you know, put money in the indices or big indices and forget about it. You know, that's the way. So I only wanted to highlight that, you know, even to a very, very routine view that banking can end up doing reasonably well, there are significant headwinds there too, not just at a bank level, but also at a banking at a business level because it's getting disrupted. You know, I hope you sort of understand this.
Sure, sure. I think last two questions, Manish bhai, the last second last question is from Akhilesh. What if this mid phase of macros continues for a longer than expected time? Also, yes. Please say something on China plus one phenomenon.
Yeah, so you know, mid phases, mid cycles typically last, you know, like in 2000, after 2004, you know, mid phase lasted for three and a half years, okay? But in 2009-10, mid phase lasted for just 3-5 months, okay? So in a sense, as I said in the beginning, that while it's rhythmic, you know, the early cycle gives into mid cycle and eventually gives into late cycle, no one actually ex ante know that how long will it last. So therefore, this conversation between us must continue, and we must continue to diagnose whether it's we are entering late cycle or we aren't, okay? So he's right that it is possible that the mid cycle can last for 3 years. And therefore, in this period, you may end up earning 4-5% over bond for 3-4 years. But as I said, and I tried to enumerate all the data, which is sort of trying to hint that, you know, there it is getting infiltrated by data, which is symptomatic of a late cycle. So be aware of it. And, you know, perhaps it may not last for 3-4 years. My base case right now, Arun, is that I think this mid phase will last for about 1-1.5 years at least right now. And in that, you know, you should be neutralish equity. As I said, neutralish equity means, you know, maybe large cap oriented equity instead of, you know, smaller mid caps oriented one.
Sure. So my last question is more on the person Manish is or the philosophy around you. I know I have seen you like a child, like learning, inquisitive. What keeps you driving, right? I think want to share something about your last 20, 30 years investing into markets. How did you prepare yourself for it? And anything you would like to share to somebody like me or to other investors? How can they become better investors?
Yeah, so in a sense, you know, investing is both art and science, Arun. And, you know, I mean, I do not, you know, the whole thing of what I may have done. It's just thought that, you know, that the whole discipline is all about continuously researching and asking sort of questions and try and seek answers for them. The whole approach is, you know, build sort of primary thesis on everything possible in the world and then sort of look for data both supporting and, you know, not supporting them. And then, you know, understanding all the data points, try and conclude, you know, what is right, what is wrong, and never be sort of rigid about any view. You know, if the data changes, we'll change our view, you know, is the broad framework of investing framework that I have, you know, or forecasting framework that I have. So it's all about lot of research, lot of reading, building lot of priors or hypotheses. Keep challenging this, keep discussing, debating with good people around you, have a good company. And then, you know, sometimes sort of have stop losses on your view. Sometimes, you know, sort of continue with the view because, you know, they're actually, you know, getting into sort of a long-term profit cycle. So yeah, otherwise there is, I mean, no great trick, you know, as any business, you know, it's a good routine life. And, you know, just, I mean, as a shopkeeper works really hard to sell his wares, you know, we as investors, you know, work hard to simply understand world around us better.
Thank you so much. And you have been always an ocean of knowledge and data for all of us. Thank you so much for sparing time for all of us and our investors. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, everyone, for joining in. Thank you.
Bye-bye. Happy Diwali to all of you.
Happy Diwali to everyone. Thank you. Yes.